I actually left South Sudan because there was no freedom of expression. And my brother was killed in South Sudan.
And as we came from something to nothing.
We live in a world that is constantly struggling through crisis, conflict, and cataclysms. Throughout history, we see the best and the worst brought out of humankind during these times of hardship. We heard about a community of refugees in northern Uganda who had nothing, but decided to fight for their future. They would guide us through their story of crisis, expectations, resilience, and the complications that follow.
Have we started a new journey? And I don't want to leave this new journey in the middle.
So now that you are here and you will be put in the settlement, what do you want to do?
Why do you want to be educated? You look around this place and there's like nothing. Like there's no opportunity for jobs, there's no market, there's no town close by. Like it's literally just huts.
Adventures in Missions was contacted by a Nigerian missionary working with the South Sudanese living in northern Uganda. He invited a team of filmmakers to come to the refugee camp and tell the story of a unique community living in Rhino Refugee Settlement. After a three-day journey, we arrived at the camp. There, we were introduced to Samuel and Jackson, two South Sudanese refugees who offered to guide us around the refugee settlement.
In the place, Tika 4.
Tika 4?
So these refugees, that's, they have just come. So they want to take them long there. But those ones there, see that house there?
Yeah.
Is for all the refugees who have been here.
For a while?
Yeah, for a while.
But these ones are new.
These are new refugees. I dream to be a great man, like to become a doctor by God's grace. So that I can go and serve my people. And not only that, because I can do many things, and also I want to be a peace ambassador, somebody who can promote peace and also try to teach people about love in South Sudan. That's what I want to do.
Yeah. You can speak all the languages.
Yeah, I can speak.
Ooh.
I can speak Swahili of Kenya. Swahili.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah,
thank you. I really appreciated it.
Hey, what's up? I'm Jackson. I have my challenges too. I can't go to school now and whatever. But I think like there's a chance somewhere. And I just have to keep working hard for it. I have to like keep trying. It doesn't hurt to try. I think like people need to know that where people are alive, there's hope.
Samuel and Jackson were excited to take us to a specific community within the Rhino Refugee Settlement. In the midst of an overwhelming situation, this unique neighborhood had come together to build a school from nothing. These people believe Hope Primary School is the way forward from this crisis.
South Sudan is on the brink of a cataclysmic event, according to the United Nations.
The gunshots, people are looting our things. If you don't give them what they want, they rape you.
The Republic of South Sudan, ravaged by a three-year civil war and unthinkable violence, is creating Africa's largest and the world's third largest refugee crisis.
If you're lucky enough, they just take your things and they leave you. So if you have no good luck, they just kill you.
Since the South Sudanese war broke out in 2013, it is estimated that 2 million people have died as a result of war, famine, and disease caused by this conflict. In response to the increasing violence, over 4 million have fled their homes. Uganda hosts over 1 million of these people, and 60% of the South Sudanese refugees are children.
After spending a few days in the camp, it was clear that the harsh realities of living here were felt by everyone. Jackson took us to visit a man named Esborn. Esborn and his family's story helped us better understand the journey that many refugees experience while fleeing the war to seek safety. Esborn, it's good to see you again.
Thank you.
How are you?
I actually left South Sudan because there was no freedom of expression, and my brother was killed in South Sudan. Actually, my brother was a teacher. He was a teacher in South Sudan. So, of course, in South Sudan, those of the government suspect people that the people are all rebels. I don't know. Maybe they heard something about my brother. Then they came on 11th of August to arrest my brother. Immediately, they shot up my brother. They killed my brother. Yes. Then I decided also to fear for my life that sometimes maybe they will come also and arrest me. And so I started to come out with my family and even the kids of my brother. Really, brother, I'm really very sorry because of my country. You know, if you can see my age now, I'm becoming very old. This is my second time of coming here as a refugee.
We came to find out, for the adults in the camp, being a refugee is nothing new. For many of them, including Samuel and Jackson, this is their second time in Uganda as a refugee. So, you got here with your family, you found them
just over near the border. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then you went through the reception center.
Yeah.
And then they placed you here.
Yeah, they placed me here. Yeah.
And how long have you been here?
It's 1 year and 3 months like that.
1 year and 3 months?
Yeah.
When the South Sudanese cross the border over to Uganda, they become dependent on a land not their own. To understand the strength and resilience it takes to face this situation and establish a school, we explored what it looks like to start over, to go from something to nothing.
The South Sudanese left their nation with the things they could carry. After trekking through the bush, attempting to avoid both rebel and government forces, the refugees crossed the border into Uganda. As refugees cross the border, they are processed by the Ugandan government and then sent to a reception center in one of the many refugee settlements. Today, right now, we're going to the reception center, and the reception center is the area where they get all the new refugees at the border of South Sudan, and they bring them to this holding facility. And here's where they get checked in, they get their identification, and then hopefully in a short amount of time they get placed at their plots of land, and they get their supplies and things like that. So
we wanted to get permission to go inside the reception center at Rhino Refugee Settlement to hopefully talk with refugees who had just come from South Sudan.
You guys come in. So we heard that a new transport of refugees is going to be coming in this afternoon. Around 1 o'clock, roughly 200 refugees will be coming in, and these are refugees that literally just left a war zone. I'm excited to go back and just to meet them and really talk to someone that just left it.
Do any of you speak English? Huh? Do any of you speak English? Well,
yes, we try back.
Try?
Some.
Can I ask you some questions about you and South Sudan?
Yeah, we are Sudanese.
Yeah. Can we film? Can we film you on camera?
Yeah.
I'm Donovan. What's your name?
I'm Ramadan.
Why did you leave South Sudan?
There is a lot of war and we will not have enough for our school.
So now that you are here and you will be put in the settlement, what do you want to do? Do you want to go to school?
Yes.
Do you want to start a business?
Yeah,
what do you want to, no business.
Yes, business.
What do you want to do?
School. School. Learn.
So you want to learn how to be a doctor. Where will you find school? How will you find school?
Find school. Take a phone.
Why did you leave South Sudan by yourself?
Because South Sudan is not peaceful. There's a lot of insecurities. That's why I came here to seek for safety and guidance here, so that I get everything free of charge and I get my living or earn my living here. Everything UN provides for me. So I earn living by all the free gifts and everything that UN gives me, yeah, makes my day good.
Why did you come here?
Oh man, I'm coming for education, for study.
For studying?
Yeah.
Why do you want to be educated?
To be someone tomorrow.
The people that I talked to were more like excited to be here, and they were like, life here is great, we sleep well, my family's here, like food is provided for us. One guy said that the only food they get is beans. He said that's the hardest part. I expected fear and just like maybe trauma, but the people that I interacted with seemed happy that they're here and safe and excited for the future.
And I have the opportunity to get relocated with these refugees and actually set up like a tent and like live with them for 1 or 2 days, and so really experience what the first 48 hours of a refugee life is like. So that's something I'm looking forward to tomorrow. So we are in the reception center, and today we have the opportunity of going and setting up a camp with the refugees to get placed with them in the camp and spend the first 24 hours with them. We're here waiting to get on the bus, and there just seems to be like a lot of people. And I think the problem is the list that is for the bus is comprised of people who get ration cards, but they're family-based. So if your family has 4 people, then you get 1 ration card. So it doesn't look like there's many people on the list, but each number, each family can have a lot of members. There's one family that's 16 members on 1 ration card. But yeah, I don't think we're gonna be able to make it on this bus. There's just way too many people. There's lots of confusion about who's going and who's staying. But hopefully this bus will leave and another one will come and we can go check it out. But right now it's a little chaotic.
When I was born, I met some name.
I'm gonna put that on.
So we made it to our placement. We are in Tika 4, which is the name of this settlement. And the ride over here was crazy. But for the most part, everyone was pretty happy. They seemed excited about starting this new life and getting their new home and getting their placement. You know, they've traveled for so long to get to this point, and they spent time in the reception center, and now they finally got their placement. So there was like a lot of optimism on the ride over here. But I think once people arrive here and they start to know their surroundings and what's going on, their motivation or their mindset tends to change. The water here is a huge problem. There's just not enough water for as many people as there are here. And another thing too is when they hand out the tents and supplies, they only hand out one kit per ration card. How does it feel to be here?
It's good.
Yeah, why? Why do you feel good?
I feel good because the environment is okay.
Yeah. So right now, all of the new arrivals are getting briefed on their location and the things around them. But we found out that the secondary school is here, but it's 10 kilometers away. There is a clinic, but it is also 10 kilometers away. And there's a primary school. How far is the primary school? Very far.
Very far.
She's far away too. So I think just the reality of this situation and this settlement is beginning to weigh in on like the refugees, and they're starting to realize that there's still lots of problems here, still lots of struggles here.
Like that?
Sure.
Yeah.
That means that hole has to be a lot deeper.
Yeah.
Wow. We wanted to make a shelter the whole time, but the way that people here do it is they usually just sleep outside for the first night or stay with relatives because the process of building a home takes a lot of time, and there's really not such thing as a temporary structure. And so it was kind of hard for us to get all the poles and all the digging and all the just like process kind of in order, but it was kind of cool to see the community come together to like help us out. It seemed like everyone in this village like wanted to help us like build this structure, which is kind of cool. And so we've had a lot of help and got all the supplies we needed. But rain is like all around us in all directions, which is kind of crazy, just kind of looming over our head. So we're hoping to finish this structure before it starts pouring down, because I don't know what our backup plan would be, but. Yeah, last night was good. We got to hear a little bit of Isaac's story and did like an interview with him. I think the thing that stuck out to me the most from like the talk with him was by being here, by being a refugee, he feels that the UN is responsible for his future, which is something new that I've come across is. That he says, if I don't get education, like if my family isn't provided for, if I don't get all these things, then the UN is to blame because they're the ones that have taken me in and given me this shelter. And like you look around this place and there's like nothing, like there's no opportunity for jobs, there's no market, there's no town close by, like it's literally just huts in the middle of nowhere. And so you need money. As we left Tika 4 camp and made our way back to the rest of our team at Rhino camp, I couldn't help but think of all the anticipation these new refugees had. The optimism I saw at the reception center and during the relocation was a little shaken when the reality of Tika 4 began to dawn on them. But they still had hope. What would happen when they realized that some of their expectations could not be met?
So you thought when you came here, you thought secondary school would be easy to find and it would be provided?
Yeah.
But now that you're here, you see that that's not true?
Yeah.
Why did you think that secondary school would be here? Because it was in South Sudan?
Because I thought it's supposed to be arranged from here. But I've seen the situation that it's only primary that's around.
So then what do you do in your situation? Will you travel to a secondary school? Will you wait for one to be built?
Maybe I'll just have to wait because I don't have the money to travel.
Back in Rhino Camp, we met Hakeem Alfred, who had been appointed as headmaster of Hope Primary School. This community decided that they couldn't wait for someone to come and provide a school for them. They took the education of their children into their own hands.
We can't keep on waiting. The children are growing. The more we wait, the more they grow. And at the end, they lose interest in learning.
I'm a teacher, Moses Taban Yokonya. Not an employed teacher, but a volunteer teacher. And I love teaching.
Do you think these people here in Hope School and this generation is a generation that can bring change?
Why not? If we give more effort and if we raise them to the standard, these are the people that will serve the nation tomorrow. Yeah.
A generation that does not go to school is a generation that I can say it is like a generation born without eyes. It's blind completely. For me, who is a teacher by profession, I don't feel comfortable when I see children meandering around without going to school. When I trace back into our history, literacy rate is very high. Around 2003, 2004 to 5, it had been rated to be 80% of South Sudanese are illiterate. And if illiteracy is very high, automatically there are many crimes coming in. We have different people in our country with different family backgrounds and different cultures. Without education, each one will treat his or her culture more important than the one of the neighbor. For example, you kill my relative, I kill your relative. How shall we stay together? It will become difficult. But through education, you will come and reconcile and sit together and share together. And if you're not educated, I remain your permanent enemy and you remain my permanent enemy. If education is not there, all these crimes will continue. You see, alcoholism is also another problem. You know, people drink excessively because they are idle. They don't have jobs to do. What do you do? You have not been to school. You don't have a job. What do you do? This is mainly because the level of understanding is very low. There's no positive thinking in a generation which has no education. See? So education is very, very important. That's why I said a generation which exists without education is like someone who is born blind. You can't see what you are doing. You can't see the direction you are taking. You see that? So education is a paramount, you know, aspect in life, because you'll be able to plan for yourself, you'll be able to plan for the community.
So how does Hope Primary contribute to that effort to bring peace to South Sudan?
Hope Primary is really doing great thing. This one before Hope Primary, Osea Primary School is the only school here in Osea zone. So there had been many, many students in one class. So now the Open of Hope Primary have taken some of the students to go to Hope and is now helping grade that children are now moving there to study. And also they are really teaching very good. And also teachers there, they don't discriminate that this is from this tribe or this is from this tribe. They really treat everyone equally. And that treatment of everyone equally will promote peace.
Yeah, I don't
so really they are doing great things.
Maybe I want to welcome one of my colleagues, the director of the studies of the school, maybe.
For us who are teachers, we can't sit and wait for someone to come and eradicate illiteracy in our country. So we have to begin. You know, we are refugees now here, but being a refugee does not mean that you cannot have access to learning. Learning continues.
The leaders of this community had taken a census of how many children in their particular cluster needed a school to go to, and the response was overwhelming. Over 700 children had no access to education. Alfred and seven other community leaders began Hope Primary School.
And they willingly were like, yes, I'll move because of the school.
Yeah.
Can you tell us that story again?
Within the school compound which we have occupied, who were here but they willingly accepted to move and leave the school for the school. I mean the place for the school.
The thing that struck me was when he talked about how they had their plot of land, they had chosen their plot of land, and there was two families living on it. And when they presented the idea to the family, we want to build a school, there was no hesitation from the family. They said, we support you. They packed up their house and moved their house so that the school could be built. So you had these two blocks built?
Two were.
Small kids were being taught in.
The primary trees were under that tree.
Okay.
So this had been the tree which was hosting our children as a classroom.
Really amazing how they had two classes sitting around a tree, and they said they literally would move the class with the shade all day long, and they would take the chalkboard and they would nail it in different places. A whole term.
For the whole term, yeah, there was a classroom here. Yeah. Primary 1 to primary 7, they were carrying their seats on their heads.
They carried their chairs.
Yep, yeah.
I mean, if that doesn't show like motivation and just like devotion to education no matter what, I mean, that's what this school is built on, and that's what makes this school so special. So yeah, that was an amazing story.
In addition to combating illiteracy and tribalism, Alfred's vision for Hope Primary School also includes educating girls, with the hope that this generation of children will grow up seeing the girls and women as equals.
There are other cultures which are no longer helpful. They're not healthy. So like cultures of saying, girls are only prepared for wealth purpose. If you're educated, you will not look at that angle because that culture is putting girls below the man. So if we continue educating our children, we will break that culture and make ourselves move equally. Because there are some parents who abandon girls. They don't want to send girls to school simply because they say girls will be married. After marriage, they will get their wealth in the form of a bride price. So why send a girl to school? So these are things that we need to cut them off and push our children equally to school. If it means sending our children to school, we don't want to discriminate.
While spending time with Alfred and the teachers of Hope Primary School, we began to understand what's at stake for them is the future of South Sudan. Without proper education for these children, they may never see peace come to their newly established nation. Although the teachers of the community dared to create something from nothing, there are still many obstacles threatening the school's survival.
Even some people are asking us, why do you continue teaching when you don't get support? Even I have friends who are pestering me to go back to Juba and, you know, begin work there and so that I can get some money. But I told them, have we started a new journey? And I don't want to leave this new journey in the middle. So that's another fear that I'm having in the school concerning the teachers.
Why did they leave? Because of no pay?
No pay. They left.
So do the kids come here for free?
Yeah. Actually, initially the parents agreed that they will pay something, but some parents completely do not have anything. There's nothing. They say they're telling us they're selling their own food ratio in order to give to the school for their children. And we felt if now they continue selling, how about their food? It's for them, because the food ratio is distributed per month. Now if you sell it all, what will you eat in your house? So it becomes a little bit complex, you know.
As Bourne's children attend Hope Primary School, yet because this school was started by a community of refugees, it does not directly receive support from the government. Unless the school receives donations from other organizations, they have to create their own resources. This school depends on parents for support. Like Esborn, many of the refugees here are uneducated. Back in South Sudan, farming was the primary source of income for most families, a skill that is not very productive here, given the small plots of land these refugees receive here in northern Uganda.
Of course, I'm not educated. Suppose if I'm someone who is educated, I could just get a job here to work with any organization here, then I can help my family.
Yeah. So you aren't educated.
I'm not educated, so at least let me educate my children so that they can put something on my map.
So hopefully they can have a better future.
I don't know, actually.
And do they go to a school near here?
Yeah, they do go to school in Hope Primary School.
Hope Primary?
Yes.
And is it free or do you have to pay for it?
I pay with money.
You do?
But I don't know, this is for the second time, I don't know, I will not get money, I know. I know that one. Because I was having some clothes here, I sold them out.
So you sold things that you had,
yes,
to send them to school this year?
Yes.
But next year,
next
you don't
term
know.
Even. It will not reach next term.
Next term?
Yeah.
So you've paid for this term by selling the things that you have, the last clothes you have.
Yes.
And next term, you don't know.
I don't know, brother. If I have something that I can help my children, like you can see some of them are walking just almost naked with the clothes which are teared, what. So this one, it is the only thing which makes me burden in my heart. And if my kids can be helped, maybe to study, because when I was in South Sudan, I do everything to them. But now in this situation, there's nothing. Yeah, there's nothing. This one is Obadiah Lasuba.
Obadiah?
Yeah, he's called Obadiah.
Is he the oldest?
No, these are the kids of my elder brother who died.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
They are two, yeah.
And you're taking care of them?
Yeah.
He feels the weight of his kids, he feels the weight of his family's legacy, he feels the weight of providing and all that thing, and he can't give anything.
Job.
Job. Can you give me a high five? Give me a high five. Hey, there you go, Shadrach's got it. One more. Oh! And you guys go to Hope Primary? Is it cool if I come tomorrow and I walk with you to school? Is that okay? Very cool. I'm really curious about getting to know Obadiah. I connected with him on our walk to school, and he just really struck me as a kid that's really motivated. What job do you want to have when you grow up? What do you want to be? A journalist. So do like what we do. That's amazing. That's what I love to do. Yeah.
Obendia. All right. Thank you. Y'all have a good day, guys. Bye. Have a good day. So right now we are going back to Izzy Bone's house, and I'm really curious about getting to know his son, Obadiah. I connected with him on our walk to school, and he just really struck me as a kid that's really motivated. He wants to be a journalist, he's involved with the school, and so I want to go back, I want to talk to him, I want to get to hear his story a little bit more. I know he's not Izzy Bone's biological son, but his father was killed in South Sudan. So I just want to find out more about him and what makes him tick. And, you know, even with all the circumstances that he's been through, why is he still motivated to take school so seriously? So that's where we're going right now.
In South Sudan, my father has told me that if I put myself in education, I will be better in future. I'm dreaming even up now. When I'm in education, education will help you in other ways, that if you have been educated, you will get money for helping yourself, helping also your parents. But if you don't been educated, you'll be lost.
And why do you want to be a journalist?
Because I want to know more about the world, and I want to see what are people doing in other places.
So what is your dream for these children when they're adults, when they're your age? What would be your dream because of Hope School?
My dream is that they have to be people who will stand by themselves. People who will be responsible, and people who would also keep on transforming the society into a positive way, not negatively. So that in future, when we return to South Sudan, we will have people who have diversity of knowledge, and people who will build good relationship with the neighborhood.
Good morning.
Their immediate neighbors, the neighboring countries, even the entire world.
And then in South Sudan, all that we have, they have gone. And as we came from something to nothing. And then again, for you to stay idle, you know, your mind, you'll be disturbed. You'll be traumatized more. You know, that kind of oppression and torture, where you become more traumatized to think on the past. And if you find yourself, you are doing something, sometimes it keeps you moving. When you find yourself you are doing something, sometimes you find that you are free.
So yesterday I sat down with Obadiah and I got to hear a little bit of his story. He mentioned that journalism is something that he wants to pursue. And so I thought it'd be cool today just to like go with him, give him my camera, and we'll just go around in the community taking photos, maybe some videos, and just kind of teach him a little bit more about the craft that I've chosen, and hopefully maybe inspire him to continue pursuing that. Well, first, all right, important rule of photography. You gotta ask for permission first. So you gotta ask him, can I take your photo?
Not a photo. Can I take your photo?
No.
Can I take your photo?
No.
All right, then we keep moving. But good things about like trees and ducks is that they can't say no. So you can take photos of them anytime. Put it up to your face, your right eye, and press the button when you're ready. That was pretty good. Got your face in it. If you could tell any story of this camp or this community? Like, what would you want to tell? Yeah, like, what would you want to write about? You could write about school, you could write about football. You could write about the UN. What would you want to write about?
I want to know how is Hope starting, and why are teachers teaching without payment, and who started Hope. I want to know these people who started Hope, yeah.
That's good. Do you know whose place this is?
Yes, I know.
Whose is it?
The one of headmaster.
You want to take a photo of the headmaster?
Yes.
Let's do it. Okay. Alfred.
Yes, please.
I'm here with Obadiah.
Obadiah wants to become a journalist.
He does.
Good.
So we're teaching him some things.
That's very good.
All right. Now for this, let's pick a background that looks good. Oh, close. All right, try to get his feet in it. Nice. You want to show him?
Do I look like a primary school child?
You do. You look like a headmaster.
Okay.
Obadiah was telling me that he's really interested in how the school was started. Mm. And he would love to come back and maybe ask you some questions. Mm. Would that be okay?
Okay,
is that cool?
Yes.
Would you want to do that?
Yeah.
Awesome. All right.
Hope started
to restore the hope of the children who are stranded, who have lost hope when they ran from South Sudan because of war. And so when they came here, they felt they would not get education again. So hope was just opened to restore peace in the mind of the children, and we saw their hope that they will continue learning. Though they are refugees, but being a refugee does not mean that you don't go to school. So often it's so that they really feel at home and feel that they are safe and they are getting education.
Thank you, Alfred, for that. Yeah, that's great. Yep. All right.
Thank you very much.
Very good job.
Yeah.
You did great.
Yeah.
Journalist.
We got a journalist. Well, you can shake Alfred's hand and thank him for his time.
Yeah. Thank you.
Would you like to take a quick photo of Alfred right now?
Yeah.
While spending time with Obadiah and the students at Hope School, I realized how these kids are willing to learn.
Yep.
Yeah, and listen.
Yep.
But if the teachers don't stay, the future of students like Obadiah is at risk. If schools are not established within the refugee settlements, the literacy and the systematic problems that have plagued South Sudan will only continue.
Why did they leave? Because of no pay?
No pay. He left. My immediate deputy left this year. On 27th, he came to me with all the books and said, "Sir, I'm going to begin a new life. Things are hard." He told me he has sold his laptop, and he had a car, he sold the car, and still the problems are continuing, so he's going to begin another life.
Against all odds, this community decided to come together to fight for their future. Instead of choosing violence like many of their countrymen, they decided education should be their weapon of choice. Their hopes and dreams for peace and progress depend on the development of future generations.
Hope Primary School has been educating their community for nearly 2 years. Since its establishment, it has impacted over 700 children and is continuing to advance and develop. But this progress comes at the cost of extreme sacrifice and bitter hardship. Even though they have moved past obstacles, there are still many complications that stand in their way.
The school started the year with 23 teachers and ended with only 13. In a school that is growing in size, losing teachers is unsustainable. These refugees have done everything within their power to move forward, to build something from nothing. But in order to continue, help is needed. The Hope Primary community needs people who are willing to join them, to empower, partner, and advocate on their behalf.
So because you care so much for education, you are volunteering at a school and not being paid. But because of that, now your own children can't go to higher level education.
That's the biggest problem that I have. Yeah. My children want to go for higher education, but I'm already stuck. I don't know what I can do. We've been putting them in a little bit better schools. But when we came here, we were very open to them. We said, now things have changed. The little that is left in our hands may push you and leave you somewhere. Please, you have to admit it, because it's not my personal making. It is the situation which has changed things negatively. So they understand the situation we are in.
Actually, as a father, I'm really stranded. Of course, there is no work here in Uganda. And the other issue, I'm not educated. That I can get a job just to help my family. Of course, if you keep on looking your kids, you don't provide them with anything, it is really very sorry. This is what in my heart. Of course, I don't fear to die. If my brother can die, why not me? Because he has left the burden even to me. Because you cannot stay in a world where you cannot afford to help your people, you cannot help your family, you are doing nothing. Still, if I am alive, they suffer. If I'm dead, they suffer. So at least I don't see their suffering. Let me die.
So I wrote this song
tell the South Sudanese that we should stop war and stop corruption, stop tribalism, and focusing for the future of our children. So this is how the song goes. We don't want any more fighting again. We don't want any more killings again. We don't want any more suffering. We don't want any more tribalism again. We don't want any more running again. We don't want any more to be refugees. We cried for peace in South Sudan. We cried for freedom in our nation, but it's nowhere to be seen. Oh, gun swords everywhere. Oh, there's killing everywhere. Oh, there's fighting everywhere. Oh, we are refugees everywhere. In the world, why only us are Sudanese? Oh. Let us forgive ourselves here and teach our children good moral. When we go back to South Sudan, we'll have a good future. God bless you.
Thanks for watching our film, A School Called Hope. My name is Joe Barnes, and I'm the producer for this film.
And my name is Tiara Menavar, and I'm one of the directors and editors of this film. And we are so thankful for people like you that make projects like this possible.
If you would like to get involved, there are three different ways that you can do so. The first way is by empowering the Hope Primary School community, parents and teachers alike. If you're a professional, you can come alongside the refugees of the Hope Primary School community. For more information, please contact the Greater Hope Project.
Secondly, you can donate. Our common belief is that helping people should not be a handout, but a way to invest in a lasting and sustainable future. The Greater Hope Project aims to provide a platform where communities can thrive together.
Lastly, you can advocate on behalf of the South Sudanese. It is our responsibility to make sure these stories do not go unheard. Go to aschoolcalledhope.com to learn more about how you can host your own screening of the film.
Thanks again for watching our film.
Thanks, everyone.